If you have a Bible with you this morning, and I hope that you do, take it out or your device or reader, whatever it is that you're using this morning. If you don't have a Bible and you need one, there should be one in one of the racks in the row in front of you, so feel free to grab that and use it if you need it. Take it with you. If you don't have a Bible at home, feel free to take it with you. That's what they're there for. Take out your Bibles, though. Turn with me to Romans chapter 5. And we're continuing in the book of Romans, the sixth book of the New Testament, four Gospels, Acts, and then Romans. And we're continuing in our journey through the book of Romans. I didn't see any questions on Facebook. As we've gone through it up to this point, I've invited you. See where the sermons are going and then read ahead and post your questions up there on the church Facebook page. I didn't see any questions. Now, listen, I know I'm not that brilliant a preacher. And so I know as we've covered the first couple of chapters, I've not covered everything. I've not hit every point and explained everything well enough so it would satisfy every question that you have. So let me encourage you once again, just invite you once again. As we're going through the book of Romans, you've got questions. Read ahead. See where we're going. Read the chapter when you go home this afternoon. Read all of Romans 5. And there are things in there that you might say, oh, he didn't talk about that. Or I wonder what that really means. Didn't talk about that enough. Put your questions up there on the church Facebook page. I want this to be an opportunity where we grow together as we walk through the book of Romans. I had a discussion with a young lady this week, and I said, as a church, we're really working very hard to be a place where it feels safe for you to ask questions, where it feels safe for you to come and not know all the answers and not know everything that's going on in the Word of God. And she said, now her and her husband are not believers, and she said, I felt that. That's why I've come back. That's why we come back week after week. And so that question you post up there may not only be for you. It may be for someone else to say, you know, I've seen Mike and Christy in the service, and they seem like they have their act together, and yet they put this question up there. They don't seem to know everything. If they can ask a question, maybe it's safe for me to do it too. So as we're going through Romans, I encourage you, put your questions up there on the Facebook page so we can grow together. Obviously, I'm still in the recovery phase of this flu. I was out last week, and I just want to give a public thank you to Sam Owens for filling in last week. I sent him an alert message Friday and kind of put him in alert status and said, listen, I've got a fever and stuff, and I'm not sure what this weekend's going to look like. So if you've got a sermon squirreled away somewhere, Matt, now might be a good time to pull it out and dust it off and see. Sent him a note on Saturday and said, yeah, this is going downhill fast. So I'm not going to be there Sunday, so I appreciate Sam jumping in, filling the pulpit last week. I'm still in the recovery phase of this. So I still have, if you had this thing, I don't even know what to call it, this thing. But if you've had it, there's still the sore throat, there's still the cough that just lingers. Now, what that means for you today is a shorter sermon. Yeah, I know, right? You know, pastor says, I don't even know what that means. What those words mean, coming from a preacher, shorter sermon. You know, it's when the preacher looks at his watch. You know what it means when he looks at his watch? Nothing, absolutely nothing. When the preacher says, in conclusion, you know what that means? There's 15 minutes left of the sermon. That's what that means. But I will try to keep the message shorter today. I'm not sure how long I'll be able to hold the cough at bay. But a pastor friend of mine did say this. He said, from the perspective of the congregation, there's no such thing as a bad, short sermon. So, but I want to do justice to Romans chapter 5 nonetheless. So let's just dive right into it. I think the big idea in Romans chapter 5 is just right there in the first verse. As he kind of turns his corner, he starts talking about the results of justification. I think the big idea of the chapter is right there in the first verse. Therefore, having been justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ. And what I want to do is spend the next 30 minutes or so just unpacking that thought and kind of looking at that. What does that mean when Paul talks about this idea of justification? We talked about it a little bit a couple weeks ago. When he talks about that, what is that? What is he talking about? And what are the implications of that? What does that mean to our lives as believers? Remember, he wrote this letter to a group of believers. What does that mean to them as they live out this justification? I think the first thing it means, though, is he talks about this thing that God has done, been justified by faith, and we now have peace with God. I think there's a takeaway from us in that God's changed us. You know, we came to Christ, and when we repented of sins and trusted in Christ, this is not a small matter that has happened. There has been a fundamental change in us, in our relationship with God, and our standing before God. God has changed us in a very fundamental way. Notice that first word there in verse 1. He says, therefore. And I've said this before, it's not original to me, but whenever you see that word, look for what it's there for. It points back to something. This is a conclusion he's making. He's talked through the first four chapters. He's made this idea. Remember, we started in chapter one. And he talks about how the fact of that God's wrath is just, given who we are, given the sinfulness in our lives, God is absolutely just to be a God of wrath. The wrath of God has been revealed to all man. And then he moves on in chapter 3 a couple weeks ago. We looked at this deadly epidemic of sin. God has solved it completely through Christ. And then he comes to this point in chapter 5. He says, listen, I've made this argument of the sinfulness of man. I made this argument. All have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. I've made this argument about what God has done about that bringing justification in Christ. Therefore. So what is he going to talk about now? Sort of a concluding thoughts. What does that mean? How is it that we live that out in our lives? What are the implications of all that stuff that I've talked about up to this point? And we looked briefly at this idea of justification 2 weeks ago. You remember I said it's a legal term. It talks about the way God views us. That not that we are not guilty, but that God views us as not guilty in Christ. That's what justification means. But it's an important concept to understand. It's an important part of Paul's argument. It's an important part of his theology, the justification that we have in Christ. So it's important for us to understand what it means. Think about what it means if I were to say to you, I want to justify myself. Now that means I have said something or I have done something that I can tell by your reaction you don't think is right. And so I want to justify myself, right? I'm hoping that now I can say something else, or how now I can do something else that will somehow make you view what I had done, make you view it as okay, right? So to change your perspective, change your opinion about what I've done or what I've said. The thing itself hasn't changed, though, right? Whatever it was I said in the past, what's said is said. Whatever I did before, what's done is done. I can't go back and change that. I can't go back and do it differently or say it differently. That thing is not changed. What changed is how you view it. What changed is how you react to it. That's when I say I want to justify myself, that's what I'm after. It's only the view of it that has changed. Biblical justification is similar to that. That when God looks at us in Christ, we haven't changed. We are still sinners just like we were before. That aspect of us hasn't changed. It means that though we are guilty, God views us very differently. He views us as not guilty. All that stuff he said before, Paul said up to this point, about how worthy we are of God's wrath, that's all still true. That sort of horrible but very true description he gave of man in chapter 3, verses 10 through 18. Their throats are an open grave. All have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. None seek after God. You know what? All that's still true. All of that is absolutely still true. In reality, that's who we still are. What is different is that in Christ, God views us differently. That's what it means to be justified. God's view of us. When he looks at us now, he sees Christ. He sees his Son clothed in his righteousness. He made him who knew no sin to be sin for us, that we might become the righteousness of God in him. When he sees us now as believers in Christ, he doesn't see that messed up sinful person anymore. You see, there's been a radical change in who we are. The way God views us is radically different when we come to Christ. And often we kind of think about our salvation, that's the end goal, right? Everyone, we share our faith, and we ought to. We share our faith with other people. We think them coming to Christ is the end all. That's the ultimate goal. That's the beginning. That's the start of our relationship. That's the start of this new view that God has got, the way God views us. It's not the end. It's the beginning of how we're walking with the Lord. And God has changed us in a very radical way. And our status has changed. Paul said, now we have peace with God. He views us differently. All that stuff, that horrible stuff about us is still true. But God views us very differently. Now he doesn't view us as sinful. Now he doesn't view us as wicked. Now he views us as the righteousness of Christ. And because of that, he said here in chapter 5, verse 1, we have peace with God. Peace is one of those things that we talk about a lot. I mean, you read the news or you listen to the news and you hear about it talked all the time, the peace accords and peace treaties and peace this, and we're looking for peace around the world. And you ever wonder, why can we never get it? We have a lot of smart people, a lot of capable people that are working on this issue of peace in this world. How come it seems to be always elusive? We can never quite get it. Because the greater issue is not peace brother to brother. The greater issue is not peace nation to nation. The greater issue that every one of us has to come to this point of saying, I don't have peace with my maker. I don't have peace with my creator. When that is settled in all of our hearts, then this other matter of peace is possible. And he says, in Christ, we have peace with God. I think a lot of times people think, particularly unbelievers, before we come to Christ, we think of God as this heavenly grandpa, right? That he's just so happy to see us. That day when we die and pass into heaven, God will just be so happy to see us. I was talking with Mike and Rachel's parents, Mike's in-laws, and I was noticing Frank standing out there holding their baby. And he had that grandpa glow about him, that smile that can only be described as the grandparent look. You know, and I think sometimes we have this idea that God's like that. You know, it doesn't matter who you are in this life. It doesn't matter how you've responded to him or whether you didn't. That at the end of time, we show up at heaven's door, God's just going to be so happy to see us. He's going to forget all that other stuff. He's going to forget the fact that we had no room for him in our lives. He's going to forget the fact that we completely rejected him, completely cut him out, completely disobeyed him our entire lives. He's just going to be so happy to see me that God's just this heavenly grandpa is going to welcome me into heaven. I read this interview this past week. Daniel Radcliffe, you know who he is, the young man that played Harry Potter in the movies. Daniel Radcliffe, he's an agnostic, which means he doesn't quite know what he believes about God. He's still kind of, you know, squirreling around. But he said he leans towards being an atheist. And this is what he said. He said, I'll be pleasantly surprised if there's a God and an afterlife. Well, all due respect to Daniel Radcliffe, I think he'll be surprised. I'm not sure pleasant is how I'm going to describe that encounter. But that's the mindset a lot of people have, that God is just his heavenly grandpa. And listen, when I show up in heaven, he's just going to be so happy to see me that none of that other stuff is really going to matter. But here's the way, over in verse 9 of chapter 5, Paul describes it. He says, listen, we have been saved from God's wrath through Christ. Listen, the reality is that before we came to Christ, we were not God's friends. He was not our friend. He is not this heavenly grandpa that's going to say, it doesn't make any difference what you did in this world. I'm just so glad you're here. Just come on and welcome in. Let me give you a piece of candy. That we've been saved from God's wrath. And without grace, that's where we are. There has been a radical change. Do you see that? When we come to Christ, it's not just a matter of my eternal address has changed. That when I die, I'll go to heaven sweet by and by, and I can just spend eternity in heaven with God. That's wonderful. But it's not just that. There has been a radical change in us, in our relationship with God, and how God views us. And that would have been enough, right? Had God just changed our legal standing? Had he just changed us from the standing of a condemned criminal before him to the standing of a glorious heir awaiting our inheritance, right? That would have been enough had he just changed us that way. Just allowed us to live as servants in his house. I'm not sure what that is, but we were talking about it as I was showing Lee and Pamela. We're up there in the children's ministry area. This is a great thing. I said, but it sounds a little like the rolling thunder now and again when those kids get moving up. I hear the rolling thunder. It's really just the children's ministry right above us. But it would have been enough, right, if God had just changed our legal standing before him and allowed us to live as servants in his home. I mean, think about the parable of the prodigal son. That's what he wanted. He's out there, and he's in the pig pen, and he's starving, and he finally, the Bible says, comes to his senses, right? Finally kind of realizes, what am I doing out here? And he said, listen, the servants in my father's house live better than this. They at least have food. They're not competing with the pigs, but the servants in my father's house will live better. So he concocts his plan, right? He's got this story, this speech he's going to give to dad. And he comes back, and his speech, so the crux of it is, listen, I'm not worthy. Just bring me on as one of your servants. I'm not worthy to live in your house as a son. And so he thinks he's going to come back. Listen, I just want to be a servant. That would be 1,000 times better, right, than where I am now. That's kind of what he thinks. And it would have been enough have God just changed our status like that and made us just allowed to live as servants in his home. That would have been infinitely, million times better than to be the objects of God's wrath. But he didn't stop there. That's the beauty of it. When God has changed us, he didn't stop there to say, listen, I'm just going to declare you, I'm just going to look at you and declare you not guilty. Now you can live as one of the hired help in my home. And that would have been millions of times better for us, but he didn't stop there. Listen to this, John chapter 1, verse 12. To all who received him, to those who believed on his name, listen to this amazing truth. He gave the right to become children of God. Listen, we're not servants. That's not, God hasn't brought us into his home as servants. Now, he does expect us to serve, but he hasn't brought us into his home as servants. He's not looking for a workforce. That's not what God was after. When he saved us, that radical change, that justification, that grace that we have in God, it makes us children of God. Our relationship with him is not transactional. It's not a business understanding. It's a father-son, father-daughter understanding. And if you've got children, you know what a special bond that is, what a special relationship that is. Your kids are not your workforce at home. You want them to do stuff. You want them to do chores. You want them to be responsible. But that's not, it's a very different relationship than the folks you have at work. God has made us children. He is our father. He's changed our legal standing, declared us not guilty. Then he changed our status, adopted us into his family as sons and daughters. There has been a fundamental, radical change in who you are in God's sight that moment you trusted in Christ. That's huge. Paul's talking about the implications of justification, the implications of this new relationship. Don't ever forget who you are in God's sight. That is an amazing work that he has done with us. And that makes sense, I think, of what he talks about next. Verse 3 of Romans chapter 5. He says, and not only this, but we exult in our tribulations, knowing that tribulation brings about perseverance, and perseverance proven character, and proven character hope. And hope does not disappoint, because the love of God has been poured out within our hearts through the Holy Spirit who was given to us. You ever watch like the infomercials when you're back in the States? Or the Home Shopping Network, if you're up late at night, you got nothing else to do, you turn on the Home Shopping Network, it's always on. And there'll be somebody on there, and they'll tell you all about this great product, you know, they'll tell you all these great features, and then they'll say this, but wait, there's more. And then they'll tell you about a few more things about that product, and so, but that's not all you get, right? And then they'll tell you, but wait, there's more, they'll tell you some more. That's kind of what he does there in verse 3. He says, listen, God has changed us. He's done all these amazing things for us. He's changed our status legally. He's changed our status to make us sons and daughters in his home. But wait, there's more. God's still changing us. I mentioned earlier, that moment we trusted in Christ, it's not the end. That is the beginning. That is not the time for us to say, okay, I'm saved, good. Now I can rest on my laurels and just go through the rest of my life. That is the very beginning of what God is doing in our lives. He has changed us, past tense. That is done. It's a done deal. But he is still changing us. And to understand our new relationship with him as children of the king, that makes all that stuff he just said there, verses 3 through 5, make sense. Right? That doesn't make any sense otherwise. He uses this word, exult. He said we should exult in verse 3. And he used the word three times throughout the chapter. And I've mentioned this before. If you want to know a key phrase, a key thought that any of the biblical writers are talking about, if there's a word they've repeated, it probably means it's important. Pay attention to that. The Holy Spirit inspired them to use this word a couple times in the course of this chapter. I probably ought to pay attention to it. He uses this word exalt three times throughout the chapter, and it's important. It means to boast or to rejoice in something. Now, plug that thought back into verse 3 for a second. Not only this, but we boast in our tribulations. Now, apart from our understanding of our relationship with God as his children, that's nonsense, right? That doesn't make any sense. What do you mean boast in my tribulations? What do you mean rejoice in the hard stuff that's going to happen in my life? What does that mean? What am I supposed to do with that? But because of this great change that God has made us, the legal standing, declaring us as his, adopting us into his family, we are to exult, rejoice, boast even in our tribulations. Now, that idea of boasting or rejoicing in trials and difficulties is a common theme in the New Testament. But why? I mean, is there something wrong with us as Christians? That now that we've trusted in Christ, somehow we've lost our mind? We're supposed to look at the hard things of life and rejoice in them and boast in them and say, great, I'm glad things are going poorly. Is that really the message that he's passing on? I don't think that he is. We're not to rejoice because of our tribulations, but to rejoice within them. An understanding of who we are in Christ, who the Father sees us as, now it helps us make sense of that. We can rejoice in those tribulations. We can boast in those tribulations because of what's happening behind the scenes. Let me read those verses again. I want you to listen for the pattern. There's a pattern there. And just listen to it as Paul explains what's going on. He said, not only this, we exult in our tribulations, knowing that tribulations bring about perseverance. Perseverance, proven character. Proven character brings about hope. So there's a pattern. God is doing something, and it's not just these random things. These things that happen to us in life are not these random events, suffering for suffering's sake, difficulty for difficulty's sake. It's all left up to random chance or karma or whatever kind of crazy idea you want to throw at it. There is the hand of a loving Father who is behind all of that, allowing things in, causing some other things, yes. But there's the hand of a loving Father behind that. It's going somewhere. There's a purpose. There's a meaning. God is doing something. We've all had that experience he talked about, right? With perfect hindsight, we can look back to a tribulation, a difficult time we had in our lives. We can look back to it and we say, you know, I didn't like that. That wasn't a lot of fun. I'm glad those times are over. But we can look back and we say, but you know, there was a lot of growing that happened during that time. And as a matter of fact, I in a very real way, I can say I am the person I am today because of that. We've all had that experience where we can look back on a tribulation, a difficulty, and see that happen. And he said, this process, when we recognize that there is a loving hand of God behind those things that are going on in our lives, that God is allowing a certain measure of them through for a reason. He's going somewhere with this. He said, this produces hope. And this is the kind of hope that will not disappoint. We've talked about hope a couple of times. This idea, we talk about it at Christmas time, we're going through the Advent season, we talk about hope. This idea that we generally have of hope that's really not kind of tied to anything. Well, I hope it's not going to rain this weekend. I hope I'll get that promotion. I hope I'll get this next assignment. They're not tied to anything. Hope is this idea of wishful thinking, right? But he said we have a real reason to hope. And a hope that, by the way, is not going to disappoint. Here you might say, I hope it's not going to rain this weekend, but it probably is going to. And so you know, I hope is going to disappoint at some point in time. But he said, this hope will not. And why won't it? Because it's tied to something. He said, hope will not disappoint, verse 5, because the love of God has been poured out within our hearts. And that it's interesting, that word there, it's in the present tense. He said, because the love of God has been poured out. It's sort of this present tense understanding of the fact that God has poured out this love. But in the original language, it could also mean a future tense. Or hope will not disappoint. That's in the present tense. But it can also mean the future tense. He's pointing to the future. It not only does not disappoint now, but it will not disappoint on into the future. There will never come a point in time when this hope that we have put in what God is doing will disappoint us. That hope will not disappoint. And he says, because the love of God has been poured out into our hearts. And that word, that phrase, poured out. It's got this idea of dumping more than you can possibly ever take on. That's the word that he's talking about right there. You've heard the phrase drinking from the fire hose, right? And when you got here, you moved to Alviano, there was that period of time you were drinking from the fire hose. If this is your first assignment in the military, for very early in your marriage, all of those changes, right? Now we've got a new lifestyle. We're a military family now. We're newly married. All these changes. I'm drinking from the fire hose. And oh, by the way, now we live in a foreign country. I got a new job. I got to figure my way around. I got to figure out why are all the outlets in my house a different size? I got to figure that out. And what is it about the way Italians drive? I got to figure that out, right? All this stuff you're drinking from the fire is completely overwhelmed, right? That's what it means. That's the same idea. He said, listen, you know why this hope doesn't disappoint? Because this loving Father who is behind what's happening in your life has poured out his Spirit into your life in such a huge amount, it's like drinking from the fire hose. You'll get a little bit of it. You'll be able to process some of it. But there's so much of him, you won't be able to process even so much of how he's given you, the amount of his Spirit that he's given you. He said that his hope will not disappoint. It's no surprise that the vision that God's given this church ultimately ends in the bringing of hope, bringing this kind of hope, bringing connecting people to Christ so that they can see this hope in their lives. Because as God works that in us individually, he's working that in us corporately as a body so that we can be the instruments that bring his life-giving message, his hope to this community. You know, there's a sense, I think, that sometimes we want to shield God's reputation from difficulties in our lives. You know, maybe we have a hard time explaining, I don't really know how God would use this thing. This is tough, and it stinks, and I don't really know how God would possibly use it. So there's a sense that sometimes we want to shield his reputation. So I don't want to give God credit for the hard stuff that's going on in my life. And so we kind of distance him from it. Well, these things are happening, but God has nothing to do with them. God is completely separate from the hard things that are happening. God brings all the blessings, all the good stuff. Yeah, I'll give God credit for that. But I have a hard time explaining how his plan might work in this difficult thing. So I want to separate him from it. Sometimes we want to shield his reputation. Santa Claus theology. That's what J.I. Packer calls that. This idea that God is just this heavenly Santa Claus and he'll just pour out a bunch of presents on us. But the difficulty, he won't allow those into our lives. But Paul's message here is, listen, those things that are happening, the tribulations that are going on, those things are not apart from the hand of a loving Father, of a Father who's invested in your future, invested in you and I becoming the people that he wants us to be. And he's going to use the circumstances of this life to shape us into that person. So why would God do that? Why would God be involved in bringing hard stuff? I mean, couldn't he do it through easy stuff? I mean, couldn't he just give me a better roses for life and just make everything easy? Wouldn't that be better? I'm sure we enjoy that a whole lot more. Why would God do that and bring in difficulties? Remember a minute ago I said that our standing as God's children is what helps us make sense of what he said in verses 3 through 5. What parent? You know, what parent doesn't want to see their children grow? What parent doesn't want to see their children mature? What parent doesn't want to see their children fill the potential that you as a parent can see in them? And as parents, you bring circumstances in their life sometimes, right, to help them grow and to help them develop into that potential that you can see in their lives. What parent, one of us among parents don't want to do that for our children? Think about God, the infinite measure in which God would want to do that in our lives. And over in chapter 8, verse 29, he said he is conforming us to the image of his Son. And sometimes that conforming process hurts a little bit. He's got to chip off the rough edges. He's got to work through some very difficult things in our heart and some difficult things in our lives. And more importantly, he's got to get us to the point of recognizing that. That's the hardest step sometimes. And he's conforming us. God's at work. That's what helps us make sense of what's happening. We say, I don't understand what is going on here. This is a difficult circumstance, far beyond anything that I ever thought that I could handle, far beyond anything I ever thought I could do. And God is saying, and that's exactly the point, to bring you to the place where you recognize that you're desperate for me, more desperate, bring you into a closer relationship with me. And there are many that view Christianity as just like every other religion. There's this set of rituals we do, this set of rules that we follow, and we do those things to make ourselves feel better. And you may view Christianity that way, but the Bible presents God very differently. Not this distant, uncaring God that says, all right, stuff's happening, whatever, I'm not involved.
But as a loving heavenly Father that's very much involved in the things that are going on in our day-to-day lives. In fact, so much so that he's bringing some of those tribulations. That's what enables us to exult in him, to rejoice in him, to boast in him. Not in what God is doing, but the God who is behind it. And we're changed by his grace. He has changed us. He is changing us. And I think here's the other message in these first verses of Romans 5 is that God will finish what he started. God has begun this work in us, he said in Philippians chapter 1. He who began a great work will be faithful to complete it. God has begun this amazing work, and he's going to finish it. He's not going to leave it undone. He's not going to give up halfway through and say, you know what? That's a tougher nut than I thought it was going to be to crack, so I'm going to give up on this one. God will finish the work that he started. Verse 6 of Romans chapter 5. He says, for while we were still helpless, at the right time Christ died for the ungodly. For one will hardly die for a righteous man, though perhaps for a good man someone would dare to even die. But God demonstrates his own love toward us, and that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. Now very often we hear those verses in particular and we think of evangelism, right? Anytime you've shared your faith, if you've learned the Romans Road, and I'll put the verses of the Romans Road up on the Facebook page later this afternoon. I'm going to go through them this morning. But if you ever heard the Romans Road, led someone down the Romans Road, shared your faith that way, you come back to this verse, Romans 5:8. But while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. And we often think of those verses in an evangelistic way. And it's not an inappropriate application of them. But remember who Paul's writing to. He's writing to a group of believers. He said over in chapter 1, verse 7, he said, the beloved who are in Rome, he's writing to believers. He's not trying to convince them to come to Christ. He's talking to them about what that means, what it means to live life as a believer. So when he talks about this, it wasn't intended initially to be an evangelistic passage. He's talking to believers. I think his point is this, that listen, as believers, if God was that diligent with respect to you, when you had no time for him, if God loved you that much, when you wanted nothing to do with him, if God was that concerned about you, that concerned about who you are, when you turned your back completely on him, if he was that diligent about you when you had no time for him, how much more so now that you're his child? How much more so now that he's your heavenly Father? How much more is he going to continue to be invested in you? It's a huge message of assurance for us to say, listen, I'm going to mess up. There's going to be times I'm not going to follow everything that I know my Father wants to do in my life, everything he's told me to do. I know those times are going to come. But listen, if God was that interested in me when I wasn't interested in him, how much more so is he invested in me now as his child? He's not going anywhere. He's not going to walk away. Remember I said last week as we look at Romans 3:23, one of those other passages on the Romans Road. When God saved you, there was no delusions in God's mind about who you are. There was no pipe dream about the fact that this son or this daughter will always obey me perfectly. God had no delusions about who you were going to be when he saved you. And this is a huge message of assurance for us to say that God is faithful. He will be faithful to finish what he started in my life. These challenges and trials he's bringing are for a purpose, and he's going to see it through. Because God's grace is not just a moment of salvation thing. God's grace is an every moment of every day thing. We live in an atmosphere of grace. That's how John MacArthur phrases it. We live in an atmosphere of grace as God's children. It's an every moment of every day thing. And then look at verses 9 through 11. Much more then, having now been justified by his blood, we shall be saved from the wrath of God through him. For if while we were enemies, we were reconciled to God through the death of his son, how much more, having been reconciled, shall we be saved by his life? And not only this, but we also exult in God through our Lord Jesus Christ, through whom we have now received the reconciliation. But wait, there is even more. That's what he said in verse 9. But how much more than that? He said, listen, doesn't it just absolutely blow your mind When you think about all that God has done for us in Christ, changed our legal standing, adopted us as sons and daughters. And we say, but wait, there's even more than that. He's engaged in our lives every day, every moment, molding us into the image and the likeness of his son. But wait, there's even more. He didn't stop there. His goal is to bring us to that attitude in verse 11. Where's that exult? There's that word again. He used the second time in this passage. There again in verse 11. What are we to exult in now? Earlier he said, exult in the trials, exult in the tribulations, knowing that there's a process that God is moving in your life. What are we to exult in? This is sort of where he's bringing us to. Exult in God. No longer looking at what's happening around here as this is the end all be all. My focus is only here. But lifting our view up. I'm no longer just exulting in what's happening because I know God's got a plan. I'm exulting in God himself. These are almost irrelevant. What is happening to me in this world. My focus of life is to see God, to see his glory. That's why it's important to be connected to the body of Christ. You know, I'm literally almost preaching to the choir this morning, right? But that's why it's important to be connected to the body of Christ. And in today's day and age, we have the internet options, and you can watch church services online and that sort of thing. And by the way, you can watch our services online. We record them, put them up on our YouTube channel. We are going to try to live stream again here pretty soon. We'll see how that works out. But you can watch if you miss service or whatever. You can watch it on YouTube. But there's almost a temptation to, well, I don't need to be involved in church. But I can watch a sermon. I can watch something online. And I can worship God anywhere. And I can be disconnected from the body of Christ. But the church, the Hebrew writer said, Hebrews chapter 10, is to encourage us to follow God's will. Ephesians chapter 4, Paul said, God assembled the church for a reason, so that we all grow up together into maturity. We grow up to be these kinds of people who are exulting in who God is, exulting to see his glory, rejoicing and boasting in the glory of God when nothing else makes sense. That's where God is leading this. That's when you miss a couple of weeks, somebody's going to reach out and touch you, poke you on the shoulder and say, this is where you've been. And we'll make sure everything's okay in your life. And that, you know, maybe you might not always welcome that phone call, but somebody's going to reach out and contact if you're gone for a couple weeks. That's what the body does. That's what the family does, so that we don't separate ourselves from the herd, so that God can continue this thing that he started in our lives. He's going to be faithful to his peace. The question is, are we going to be faithful to ours? Are we going to cooperate with what he's doing? That's where God's leading us, to this place where the things of this life are seen as nothing more than opportunities to reflect his glory. Nothing more than opportunities to reflect his grace. We exult and boast and rejoice in the God who is behind it all. Listen, sin's made a terrible mess of things in this world, in our hearts, but God has provided the fix. In Christ, God can change you. Change you from an enemy to a son, from an enemy to a daughter. In Christ, God can change you. In Christ, he'll continue to change you, molding you, shaping you into the man and the woman that he needs you to be. And we can be assured that he will not leave his work unfinished. He will be faithful to complete what he started. Would you pray with me this morning? We thank you, Lord, for your faithfulness to us. Fantastic reminder that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. The reality that you are not asking us to clean our lives up and get our act together before we come to you. That while we were at our absolute worst, you sent your absolute best. And what that speaks to us, not just at our moment of salvation, but how that speaks to us for the rest of our lives. You were concerned about me when I was in that state. How much more is your son and daughter? Father, as we enter these moments of response, this moment of invitation, Lord, I realize there may be one here this morning that's never trusted in you as Lord and Savior. Say, I don't have that kind of relationship with God. If truth be known, I'd have to say I'm an enemy of God. I'm not his friend. I'm not his son. I'm not his daughter. Father, as we come into these moments of invitation, Lord, I just pray as your spirit continues to speak,
cause the spiritual blinders to fall off their eyes. Just help them to respond. And for your children, so often, Lord, we miss what you're doing. We're so busy lamenting the difficulty that we absolutely miss where your hand is at work. And as you continue to speak even to your children in these moments, Lord, I just pray this would just be a time of us coming back to you, repenting of those moments when we doubt what you're doing, doubt who you are. Just be able to come back to you in trust, faith, love. As you continue to speak to us in these next few moments, I pray.